Welcome to the Brain Coffee Podcast, where Drs. Eric Luthard and Albert Kim unlock life's little mysteries about health, wellness, entertainment, technology, and how the brain makes sense of it all. Sit back, relax, and open up your mind.
You've been watching the stocks?
Oh, yeah. They're down and then up. I guess it's down, big down.
Big down, massive shift. Yeah. Pretty interesting. Well, certainly there are facts in play, you know, that relate to kind of whether a stock market goes up or down.
Right,
but
right.
But how the facts lead to kind of essentially a cascade of emotional responses.
I know. A lot of it's expectation. I mean, in some sense, it's kind of like the emotions you get when you're gambling or something like that. You know?
In a group, interestingly enough.
Right,
you know what
right.
I mean? Like that, but there's also this kind of group think, like
yeah.
how people kind of, you know, move together, almost, lemmings is the wrong word, but basically that the group profoundly influences the individual.
Hopefully an informed mob mentality or something
right,
like that.
Right,
yeah,
right, right. Right, 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 that's right.
So,
but risk is an interesting thing. The stock market is kind of this, it is a gambling scenario.
Exactly. It doesn't hit every time. I mean, it's a perfect setup for risk and reward, because
you get the reward, you get the dopamine.
Exactly, you have the dopamine system active, but it doesn't get activated every time. It's like one
so
out of every.
That means you have to do it more and more.
Exactly.
To get that reward.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a really well orchestrated group slot machine.
Yeah, it's essentially yes, yeah. Well, the dopamine system. You were mentioning this to me the other day. Also, I mean, the dopamine system is also involved in addiction. I mean, it's a kind of a related thing.
Absolutely. You know, what's interesting is how dopamine kind of, you know, especially as we talk about the central parts of the brain, dopamine, you know, is certainly related to the, you know, kind of pleasure and pleasure-oriented choices, gambling, addiction. But it's all, I mean, dopamine is, you know, related to movement, right? You know,
right,
like,
right.
And it really is this central kind of, thing that controls the initiation of choices and movement. And so, for instance, we kind of, as neurosurgeons, we're always dealing with Parkinson's disease.
Right, right. We put electrodes in for people who responded to dopamine receptor agonists, but they're not quite working anymore.
Right.
So we need to put in these
we
devices.
Stimulate those areas where, like, the dopamine. Now, what's interesting, and this is where kind of things like Parkinson's and movement connect to kind of risk choices, is that a small percentage of people, for instance. Again, people who have, they're losing the neurons that produce dopamine in their basal ganglia, the central part of the brain. And so what do? We put an electrode in to stimulate that area to kind of increase its activity. But as it turns out, where you lose dopamine in that area, it affects your movement. When you stimulate that area, it's also connected to circuits related to reward and choice.
Right, right.
So for instance, a small percentage of these patients with deep brain stimulators actually start to perform more risky behavior. They become more involved in gambling or more involved in, you know, kind of, you know, perhaps, you know, choices that they would not have normally made, you know, in the future, you know, like.
That's interesting. But, you know, on the flip side, it's the same circuit that rewards you for achievement, for getting
right.
something done.
Right,
and
right.
So other people are also thinking about such devices to promote good choices or, you know, better learning and memory and things like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, right. Dopamine is kind of what drives us in directions, right? You know, it's our internal reward for stuff. And that can be either bad, meaning like crystal meth or kind of the hit from a slot machine, you know, or it can be for getting across the finish line with when you're running a marathon.
Right, right. So I wonder if you took the dopamine levels of everyone involved in the stock market over the last week, if you'd see this sort of, you know, I mean, as things go down, I mean, probably the dopamine circuit's going, you know, leveling off, going down. But then you see people who want to take the risk. Prices are low,
right?
And there's a spike in dopamine.
Yes. Would dopamine predict or follow the market?
That's interesting. It's probably both, right?
I think you're right. I think it would be kind of bimodal, meaning you'd see
a response.
The risk takers, right, may get that little charge.
And they'll
right?
get a spike
like
in dopamine.
It's like the first pull of the slot machine, you know what I mean?
Absolutely.
Like, and you're waiting for the wheels to spin.
Yeah.
And so that gives you a certain level of pleasure. And then when it pays out, there's a bigger level, you know?
Right,
so
right.
I guess, how can we follow the dopamine market?
You know, maybe someone should figure out how to measure those levels instead of these neural networks to guess what the stock market is going to do.
It's interesting.
Maybe look at the biological levels of dopamine throughout, you know, people and
like look
and
at,
then invest on the basis of that.
It's like dopamine in our spit, you know what I mean?
Like, yeah, yeah. You know. Oh yeah, no. We measure things like cortisol and stress hormones and other things like that
from our saliva.
That's an interesting idea. To gauge as a bellwether for how the stock market might do based on some biochemistry in your mouth.